Have you ever looked at your keyboard and thought, why is the spacebar 6 times wider than a regular key? What's the logic behind that? Yes, space is used a lot. So is a small key that we press with the pinky. It makes no sense. The reason behind the spacebar design lies in Fitts' law, a UX principle that states that the time to hit a target depends on its size and distance. That explains why keys like Enter, Shift, or Backspace are larger. We use them often, and they're farther away. But our thumbkeys already rest on the spacebar. The distance is zero, so why is it so wide? The answer is the typewriter. In the late 19th century, the spacebar was a literal metal bar that spanned the width of the keyboard and advanced the carriage when you hit it. On typewriters, the thumbs don't rest on the spacebar. You lift your hands and press the keys hard to activate the levers, so a large bar makes it easier to hit. A century later, computer keyboards kept that shape. Even when Ctrl and Alt appeared, the bar only narrowed. It feels like a waste of space, and we press it with both thumbs. There's so much untapped potential. Some keyboard manufacturers explored that potential in the 1970s and 80s, transforming the spacebar into a cluster of keys. There were two distinctive approaches. Maltron's thumb block from 1973 formed a grid of thumbkeys, later seen on the Ergodox, the Kinesis Advantage, and the Moonlander. NAC's thumb curve from 1983 placed fewer keys along the thumb's natural arc, inspiring keyboards like the Kyria, the Corne, and the Keyboardio Model 100. But how did they go from a single spacebar to that? And most importantly, can we improve it? The obvious starting point is to split the spacebar in two, so each thumb has its own space. Most people use just one thumb, leaving the other idle, while the pinkies have to work overtime to press Shift, Tab, Escape, Backspace, and Enter. It feels like a blatant inefficiency. With a split bar, that free thumb can handle Backspace, letting your right hand stay in the homing position. Boards like the Skylung JK87 and the Keychron Q9 Plus do this. Others like the Kinesis Freestyle Pro or the EpoMaker Split 65 split the whole keyboard in half. However, our thumb has a much wider range of motion. It can easily reach inward and outward. If we divide the spacebar into four keys, as in the UHK60, we can add keys like Enter or Shift. But what about the outward and downward motion of the thumbs? Could we also split the spacebar horizontally? Yes, but it would be complicated to hit one without hitting the other. For example, if you try to press B with your thumb, you might accidentally hit the spacebar. What if we made the bottom row lower using low profile switches? This solution was introduced in the Dygma race, allowing each thumb to comfortably access up to four keys. It is also present in the Dygma Race 2 and was adopted by the USK18. However, it's not only about having more keys, but also about comfort. For example, people with larger hands or who angle their arms while typing are more comfortable arching their thumbs outwards rather than inwards. If we add outer keys, they can reach those. On the other hand, people with smaller hands or who place their arms aligned with the keyboard can reach even further inward, so let's add more keys there. And let's not forget that the thumb describes an arc, so we must curve the keys accordingly. Great! We just created the Dygma Device Thumb Cluster concept prototype. Of course, this looks pretty rough, because there's a lot of work ahead of us. For example, if we make the keys smaller, there's room for more. But it's impossible to press one without hitting the next. Okay, what if we shape the keycaps like small pyramids? This creates little gaps between the keycaps, so you can press them separately. And the concave tops let you slide your thumb smoothly across the cluster. Now, what if we made the keycaps even smaller? That would make the thumb cluster more compact and the keys easier to reach, right? Pues no. However, there's a limit to how small a keycap can be. We can't make the switches underneath smaller, and even if we could, the keycaps would become uncomfortable to press, no matter the shape. And we really tried. Rounder, flatter, thinner, even looking like teeth. But not only sloughed, this is a good takeaway. Rounded or beveled edges make it easier to move back and forth from between keys. So let's keep that in mind. There are also other things that need addressing. One, the thumb cluster arc is too flat, leading to accidental hits on B and N. This comes from the aggressive pinky stagger, how low A sits compared to S. The more aggressive the pinky stagger, the more flat the angle of the arc the thumb makes. Reducing the stagger should allow a tighter thumb arc and fix the problem. 2. The keys at the tip are hard to press individually, so maybe a larger key might help. Finally, thinner keycaps could improve bottom row reach, especially for people who type with a claw hand position, which raises the position of the thumb. Okay, the new arc for the thumb cluster seems to work. I don't accidentally press B or N with my thumbs, and the outer keys feel so much easier to press. Pressing the outermost key also feels very satisfying, although we must adjust the transition going back inwards. However, the most important finding is that the thinner keycaps make it uncomfortable for those who place their hands flat on the keyboard, which brings the thumbs down. They are like too small. But before we fix that, and since we are prototyping, why not try three rows? MX switch, low profile switch, and an ultra low profile switch. The three height setup is interesting, but results in fewer, harder to reach keys and would be really complex to manufacture. So let's go back to the previous idea. Here are the final refinements. The top row is not so thin, so it's comfortable for all typing styles, both palm and claw. The key next to the outermost thumb key is beveled on the side, making it easier to return to the homing position. There are also bevels on all the top row keys, making returning to the top row easier. And here it is! It's designed to fit everyone. You should be able to reach at least three keys very comfortably and two more easily. Though the specific keys depend on your hand size, your thumb flexibility, and how you angle your hands and curve your fingers. People with larger hands or who angle their arms inward will prefer the outer keys, while people with smaller hands or who place their hands straight will prefer the inner keys. If you have a flexible thumb, you also reach the bottom row with ease. It even considers gaming, where you shift your left hand onto WASD. That's where the inner thumb keys make more sense. We've summarized these findings in a graph. Feel free to pause the video to check it out. There's also a link to download it in the description. Okay, now you have 16 thumb keys, with at least 8 that are easy to reach. It can feel overwhelming, so let's break it down. Start with space where your thumbs naturally rest. For most people, that's the thumb key with a homing bump, but it could be one of the keys next to it, depending on hand size, position, and thumb flexibility. Comfort is what matters. Now, check which thumb you use for space. Most people only use one. That frees a key on the opposite side for backspace. Next, assign Enter to your second most comfortable thumb key. Normally, it's one of the two next to your main thumb key. Then, map other frequent keys like Shift, Control, Alt, Escape, or Delete. If you run out of thumb keys, don't worry. First, not every key needs to exist on both sides. Remove what you rarely use. Second, use advanced modifiers. A key can be Shift when held, and Backspace when tapped. Apply the same logic to layer change keys, which are like customizable modifier keys. You can have layers with symbols, numbers, shortcuts, navigation. Here is a basic thumb cluster layout. There is some redundancy, and you still press Shift with your pinky, but you have everything you need, including a layer with arrows and the number pad, and another with function keys, media keys, and whatnot. Now, let me show you my layout after almost 3 years with the Defy. I have medium to large hands and not so flexible thumbs. I claw my fingers when typing and keep my hands mostly aligned with the keyboard. My most comfortable keys are the home thumb key and the two next to it. But I can also reach inwards and outwards pretty easily. For the main thumbkeys, I have space on the right and backspace on the left. When held, both double up as layer 4 with my symbols and shift. This was a game changer for me as it increased my comfort and speed. Enter sits next to them on both sides and doubles up as layer 2, where I have my navigation, and layer 4, which are my mouse keys. The outermost keys are home to space and backspace on opposite sides. They are helpful for one-handed use when I'm using the mouse, or for pressing command backspace to delete a file or a whole line of text. Moving inward, I have command and alt. Command is the equivalent of control on Windows, and it also doubles up as del on tab. Finally, hard-to-reach keys handle secondary actions like battery check, Bluetooth pairing, LED toggle, and desktop navigation. And that's it! What do you think? Did we fix the spacebar? Or did we go too far? And most importantly, what would you do with your thumb keys? Let us know in the comments below. Don't forget to subscribe! Ciao, pescao!